So it was like OPEC week. You had this like several day seminar where even a couple of U.S. shale producers attended and gave presentations. Friday was the big meeting of producers where now going into the meeting, we had been tantalized by Russia that we could get as much as 1.8 million barrels
of supply coming online.
Of new supply coming onto the market from this group. This group includes Russia and OPEC, or OPEC and Russia, or ROPEC, as I think.
ROPEC. But wasn't there a meeting on Saturday as
well? Friday they come out with this announcement that was very weak. All they said was that they were going to adhere to the current deal and adhere to the quota, sort of eyeing or alluding to the fact that some countries would up their production to get this back, get them back down to their quota levels overall. But that was all to save face for Iran, who wanted no changes to the deal, no changes to output. Saturday was the big day then. That's when the Saudi oil minister and the Russian oil minister came together for the OPEC, non-OPEC group, which included Russia and other countries. And they came out and said definitively that they were going to put a million barrels more on the market.
So that they changed expectations from Friday.
From Friday's squishy announcement to Saturday's hard announcement that there's a million barrels.
So earlier this morning, oil was down. I now see WTI is up. But this is now what the market originally expected. More supply, hence what happens to the price of WTI over time here.
And one thing that went sort of uncovered on Friday, Michelle, was that another example of there being blows to supply in the market.
Venezuela.
Well, Venezuela, but also now Canada, had a transformer blow up that cost the market 365,000 barrels a day.
Wow.
Probably through the end of July.
Because of the electricity issues. Yes.
Electricity and maintenance, and its oil can just blow up sometimes, you know, because it's combustible. Unfortunately, things happen. But that's been sort of the story here. Global supplies have tightened markedly because of these declines in supply. I mean, Venezuela's at a 50-year production low. We could go into the whole nightmare, you know, story about what's happened there. But last week, new problems in Libya again affected several hundred thousand barrels of their production again. That keeps happening. They come back online, they go offline. And then right now with this Canada thing, but it'll clear. I think if all things were equal and we weren't having these serial issues, we'd potentially be heading a lot lower now in reaction to what the Saudis and Russians promised us on Saturday. But until we can work through some of these other issues, we're going to be supported. And I dare say it could get quite tight, and maybe we head appreciably higher to the extent these Canadian barrels are missed, because we have no spare barrels in Cushing, Oklahoma, where the WTI contract trades against as it is right now. They are at a multi-year low.
Hey, John, nice to see you again.
Same here, Tom.
We were talking earlier about Saudi Arabia and the Saudi Aramco IPO in particular. Where do you think the Saudis want to see oil right now? Brent oil is, I think, $74 a barrel. What is the right number for them, for their country, and for an eventual Saudi Aramco IPO?
Well, just to that, there was some commentary from the Saudi officials last week that they're hoping for 2019 on that IPO, but I don't think it's going to happen. I think
You don't think it's going to happen?
No.
In 19?
No, I don't think it's ever going to happen.
Ever?
If it happens anywhere, it'll happen in Saudi Arabia.
Okay, hold on. Explain this to him, because he's been spending 4 years trying to get the IPO here.
Yeah, why do you say that, John?
Then you can tell, because I don't think that they have any appetite for the kind of disclosures that our laws and exchanges
require. Because the balance sheet of the company and the country are like this.
They're pretty far down the road with respect to having financials that can be relied upon, audited by big four auditors. I think both the points you make are valid points. It comes down to one guy, Mohammed bin Salman, and he said in his Vision 2030, this is what we're going to do. And I don't think the world would look at a Saudi-only IPO as an IPO.
No, I agree with you.
And so it would require him stepping back from the centerpiece of his vision, and I don't see it happening, in particular with oil at 70 bucks.
Did they ask you to lower their listing standards?
No.
And there are reports that they asked.
They did. I'm not going to go into kind of in-depth information about conversations I had with them. But I will say, just because it's been misreported, the answer to that is no.
I mean, from the outside looking in, that's a sense we get. But to your question about the price, it's obviously right around here, because they are reacting to this price elevation, and not just from President Trump's tweets, but also from the Indian Prime Minister and China. They've come to recognize Mohammed bin Salman has changed a lot there, and they are recognizing finally that, you know, screwing consumers with $100 barrel of oil is not good for their long-term interests. It drives a lot of other technologies. It drives competing fuel sources. So they want to stay in the game, because right now, these other fuel sources, as much as we love them and maybe they're green, You can't compete with how much power and distance a gallon of gasoline, even at the current prices, gives you. There's just no competition for it, particularly as it relates to transportation. So as long as prices are here and they can sort of get along and we can all live with it globally, this is around the area that they'd like to see it stay.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.